In this video, we will review the different osteoarticular structures that participate in the structure and movements of the ankle and subtalar joints. All the drawings are from a right-sided ankle. We will progress in this order: the distal tibia, the fibula and the talus, the distal tibiofibular joint, the talocrural joint, the calcaneus, and finally, the subtalar joint. We will review these regions from different views and progress gradually, starting with the most relevant structures of the osseous anatomy, then working through the cartilage, the synovial capsule, the fibrous capsule, the ligaments, and some basic biomechanical concepts. The bones that participate in the ankle are the tibia, the fibula, and the talus. The distal end of the tibia has a quadrangular section in the axial plane. Thus, it has anterior, posterior, lateral, medial, and distal surfaces. At the lateral surface, the incisura fibularis is the area of contact with the fibula. The medial malleolus is an extension of the tibia. The distal surface for contact with the talus is concave in the sagittal plane and convex with a ridge in the coronal plane. From an anterior inferior view, we can see that the inferior articular surface continues medially into the malleolar articular surface. From an inferior view, we see that the inferior surface is wider anteriorly. The distal end of the fibula has a posterior groove for the passage of the peroneal tendons. The medial surface has a surface for the tibiofibular interosseous ligament, a triangular articular facet with a distal apex, and the malleolar fossa for the insertion of the posterior talofibular ligament. The fibula is located lateral and posterior relative to the tibia. The talus is a short bone. As seen from superior, we can distinguish from posterior to anterior the body, the neck, and the head. The head is directed distally in an inferomedial direction. The distal articular surface is convex and has an ovoid shape. The plantar surface has a surface for the anterior calcaneal surface of the anterior talar calcaneal joint. The neck has the plantar articular surface for the calcaneus at the sustentaculum tali, which corresponds to the middle talocalcaneal joint, and the sulcus tali, which is the roof of the tarsal sinus. The axis of the neck is directed down, distal and medial, in about 150 degrees with the axis of the body. The body has a dorsal trochlear surface, which is convex in sagittal and concave in coronal planes, and it's wider anteriorly. The lateral triangular facet for the distal fibula is at the lateral surface of the body. At the medial surface, there is a comma-shaped articular facet for the contact with the tibial malleolus. At the posterior region, there is a posterior process with a groove for the tendon of the flexor hallucis longus, delimited by two tubercles. The plantar articular surface of the body has the posterior articular surface for the calcaneus at the posterior talocalcaneal joint. The ankle comprises both the distal tibiofibular joint and the tibiotalar joint. These three bones and their ligaments form a single biomechanical unit. In an axial view of the distal tibiofibular joint seen from superior, we can appreciate that the articular surfaces of the distal tibiofibular joint are The tibial concave rough surface, called fibular notch of the tibia, and the fibular convex surface. The osseous architecture of the joint does not provide intrinsic stability. The stability of the joint is provided by the fibrous structures. The interosseous ligament is formed by the fibers that go from the tibia to the fibula. It is extremely resistant and continuous with the interosseous membrane. Thus, the joint between the distal fibula and tibia is essentially fibrous, also called syndesmosis, not synovial. The anterior tibiofibular ligament runs oblique with its fibers orientated lateral and distal. The posterior tibiofibular ligament has a similar orientation but is thicker. From anterior and posterior views, we can better understand that the tibiofibular ligaments go from the tibia to the fibula in a distal orientation. The distal tibiofibular joint must hold the talus tight in between the tibial malleolus and the distal fibula, supporting all the weight of the body. This implies that there is no significant movement between these two bones. The ligaments restrict the width of the tibiofibular mortise. The movements of the distal tibiofibular joint are very limited. The tibia and the fibula separate or come closer together depending on the movement of the talus underneath. During ankle extension or dorsal flexion, the wider anterior part of the trochlear surface of the talus fits into the tibiofibular mortise and tightens the ligaments, giving it more stability. The opposite happens during ankle flexion. Therefore, the distal tibiofibular joint works as a unit with the talocrural joint, also called supratalar joint. This is a synovial type of joint formed by the tibia, the fibula, and the talus. It is a hinge type of joint, also called trochlea, with a sagittal ridge and groove. The fibula and the tibia form a socket, also called mortise, inside which is located the body of the talus. This means that there is a unique transverse axis of movement that allows the flexion and extension. The articular surfaces of the mortise are covered with hyaline cartilage. The roof is the inferior surface of the distal end of the tibia. The medial side is the medial malleolus of the tibia, and the lateral side is the malleolus of the fibula, which is longer. The corresponding surface of the talus is also covered with cartilage. The synovial membrane attaches around the margins of the articular surface. The fibrous capsule is loose in the front and the back, as in all hinge joints, and it is reinforced by ligaments medially and laterally. The medial ligament has a triangular shape as a capital delta in Greek, and is thus called the deltoid ligament. The apex is to the medial malleolus, the base to the calcaneus and navicular. It has four parts. Those that go from the tibia to the talus are deep. The anterior deep tibiotalar part attaches to the medial surface of the neck of the talus. The posterior deep tibiotalar part attaches to the medial side and medial tubercle of the talus. Those that go from the tibia to the navicular or calcaneus are superficial. The superficial tibio-navicular part attaches in front to the tuberosity of the navicular and the margin of the spring ligament. The superficial tibio-calcaneal part attaches to the susentaculum tali. In a coronal plane, we can also see that the tibiotalar parts are deep and the tibio-calcaneal part is superficial. The lateral ligaments are the anterior telefibrillar ligament, from the anterior margin of the lateral malleolus to the adjacent region of the neck of the talus. It has two fascicles, the superior, which is intraarticular, and the inferior. The calcaneal fibular ligament goes from the malleolar fossa at the posterior medial side of the lateral malleolus to a tubercle in the lateral surface of the calcaneus. The posterior talofibular ligament goes from the malleolar fossa at the medial side of the lateral malleolus to the posterior process of the talus. Again, from anterior, we can see the two fascicles of the anterior talofibular ligament, the calcaneal fibular ligament, and from posterior, the posterior talofibular ligament. The calcaneus is a rectangular prism. The superior surface has three areas. The posterior area is rough. The middle area has the posterior talar facet, which is oval and convex anteroposteriorly. The calcaneus sulcus separates the middle from the anterior surface. The anterior area has the anterior and middle talar facet. The medial surface has the sustentaculum tali, underneath which is the groove for the flexor hallucis longus tendon. The lateral surface has the fibular trochlea for the passage of the peroneal tendons and an elevation for insertion of the calcaneal fibular ligament. The anterior surface of the calcaneus is the articular facet for the cuboid. The posterior surface has three areas. The superior area is smooth and covered with fat. The medial area has a ridge for insertion of the Achilles tendon. And the distal surface is the subcutaneous weight-bearing surface of the heel. The functions of the calcaneus are two: to support and distribute the weight of the body, and secondly, to adapt the foot to the ground during the standing position. This is provided by multiple joints for load sharing, with scarce movement that sum together provide a wide range of movement. The subtalar joint is that between the talus and the calcaneus. It is a synovial joint with two separated units, posterior and anterior. The anterior talocalcaneal joint has two separate joints. As for the posterior talocalcaneal joint, it has the articular surface of the talus, which is concave, the articular surface of the calcaneus, which is convex. Summarizing, both the superior surface of the calcaneus and the inferior surface of the talus has three corresponding articular surfaces. It is a trochoid joint in which the calcaneus rotates underneath the talus along the longitudinal axis that goes along the three articular surfaces. The movement of the subtalar joint is eversion and inversion. The ligaments that stabilize this joint are the talocalcaneal ligaments in the lateral, posterior, and medial regions, and the interosseous ligament in two layers, located in the tarsal sinus. The tarsal sinus is a cylindrical cavity between the talus and the calcaneus. It is located on the lateral aspect of the foot, distal and anterior to the lateral malleolus. It separates the anterior from the posterior subtalar joints. It contains blood vessels, nerves, fat, and ligamentous complex that includes part of the inferior extensor retinaculum, the lateral cervical ligament, and the medial talocalcaneal interosseous ligament.